in the previous class, we had started with the chromosomes. We have seen the definition, we have seen the DNA's structure, chromatin fibers structure. And today we have to start with the chromosome. Till chromatin fiber we have already discussed. So what is chromosome? So chromosome is present in the nucleus of each cell. What is it? When the DNA molecule is packaged into thread-like structure, it is known as chromosome. We have already seen the literal meaning. Each chromosome is made up of DNA tightly coiled around the histone proteins. We have seen here that when the DNA is tightly coiled around the histone proteins, it forms the nucleosome. Then again after coiling and condensation, it forms the chromatin. And at the cell division during the metaphase, the most coiled and condensed form of this chromatin fiber is known as chromosome. Okay, so chromosome is not visible in the cell's nucleus and not even under a microscope when a cell is not dividing. And why it will not be visible? Because at that stage, the chromosome is in the form of fine thread-like structure, that is chromatin fiber. And that chromatin fiber only after coiling and condensation, it is known as chromosome. So this DNA that makes up the chromosome becomes more tightly packed during the cell division, and then it becomes visible under a microscope. We have seen why the tightly packaging required during the process of cell division in the previous video. Now we have to see what is a centromere. Centromere is the constriction point of the chromosome, and this constriction point will divide the chromosome into two sections or two arms like this. Okay, so this constriction point is known as the centromere, and it is dividing it into two arms. The shorter arm will be known as the P arm, and the longer arm will be known as the Q arm. Okay, the centromere is the specialized DNA sequence of the chromosome that links a pair of sister chromatids. You see here, centromere is the condensed part of the chromosome. Okay, the specialized sequence of the chromosome to which these two sister, one sister chromatid and the another sister chromatid, is attached to each other. Okay, during mitosis, the spindle fiber will be attached to this kinetochore. This is the centromere, this is the kinetochore, and the spindle fiber will be attached with this kinetochore. So you can just imagine this kinetochore as a sticky substance to which the spindle fiber will attach. And when the spindle fiber will be pulled apart in the opposite direction, this centromere will be divided into two equal halves, taking the one sister chromatid to one pole of the cell and the other sister chromatid with the centromere to the other pole of the cell. And this is how from a parent cell, two daughter cells will get equal amount of its genetic material. Okay, the location of centromere on each chromosome gives the chromosome its characteristic shape. This centromere may be here, it may be here. Okay, so it may be telocentric, it may be acentric, like that. So the position of centromere on a chromosome is not fixed. It may be towards the tip or it may be away from the tip of the chromosome. Okay, this is the structure you will draw in the diagram of the chromosome. Now, what are genes? Genes are the specific sequence of nucleotides. We have already seen what are nucleotides. So the specific sequence of nucleotide present on the DNA or RNA. we have seen that there are certain viruses whose genetic material is RNA, like the HIV virus, human immunodeficiency virus. Its genetic material is RNA. So it is a specific sequence of nucleotides present on the DNA or on the RNA located on the chromosome. This specific sequence of nucleotide is located on the chromosome and which acts as a functional unit of inheritance. And this functional unit of inheritance controls the transmission and expression of one or more traits by specifying the structure of a particular polypeptide. Just see here. For example, it is a DNA, okay, double-stranded DNA. Three consecutive nucleotide is known as one gene, and this gene is going to form a protein, specific protein, okay. So this process is not a direct process. These will encode on the messenger RNA, and this process DNA to the messenger RNA formation, it is a complex chemical process. This process is known as transcription, and it occurs inside the nucleus. Transcription, TRANSCRIPTION, okay. This mRNA will come outside, and when this mRNA comes outside, the smaller subunit of the ribosome will attach to it, then the larger subunit of the ribosome will attach to it. It will scan the codons present on the messenger RNA, okay, and the anticodons present on the anticodon loop of tRNA. This process is occurring. mRNA formation to protein formation occurs in the cytoplasm, and DNA to mRNA formation occurs inside the nucleus. Okay, so inside the cytoplasm there are a large number of tRNA. Okay, so this tRNA will enter in the ribosome, and on the anticodon loop of the tRNA, this is the structure of tRNA, clove-like structure, okay, and this is known as anticodon loop. So this tRNA will enter into the ribosome, and the matching of the codon with the anticodon takes place. If the matching is successful, a amino acid will be formed. On this side, this will shift, and one amino acid is formed. Then again, this structure, this mRNA will shift, and the next consecutive codons will be scanned. Another tRNA will enter inside the ribosome. If the matching is again successful, another amino acid is added to it. So this chain of amino acid is known as polypeptide chain, and this polypeptide chain will be dropped inside the endoplasmic reticulum. You know that there are two types of endoplasmic reticulum: smooth endoplasmic reticulum and the rough endoplasmic reticulum. So on the rough endoplasmic reticulum, the ribosomes are attached to it. So whatever polypeptide chain is formed by the ribosomes, this will be dropped inside the lumen of the rough endoplasmic reticulum, and inside the rough endoplasmic reticulum, the protein, the polypeptide chains coiling, folding, and its modification occurs, and the proteins gets its proper shape. Okay, so this mRNA to protein formation is known as translation, and this DNA to mRNA formation is known as transcription. Okay, understood it? This transcription occurs inside the nucleus, and the translation occurs inside the cytoplasm. Okay, so gene is the specific sequence of nucleotide present on the DNA or on the RNA which is found on the chromosome, and it is the functional unit of inheritance. And this functional unit of inheritance will control the transmission and expression of one or more traits by specifying the structure of a polypeptide and especially a protein. This polypeptide will only be converted into protein, and this protein is controlling the many functions of the cell as well as the genetic material. So gene is the basic biological unit of heredity, because it gets transmitted from one generation to the other generation. For you to make it more clear, I have downloaded this picture from the internet, that gene are the segments of DNA, okay, and each gene contains the information about a certain trait, okay, like the color of the pupil of your eye, the color of your skin. The color of your skin depends on a protein, and which protein? That is melanin. So each and every trait of your body depends on this protein. And so genes are transcribed and translated. You have seen what is transcription and what is translation, by the cells to make proteins, and proteins creates a visible phenotype. In the next chapter, you will study about phenotype. Phenotype, just in brief, I am telling you that whatever features which can be observed morphologically is known as phenotype. Okay, so the skin color, the color of the pupil of your eye, everything is phenotype. Example, one gene might code for eye color, and this gene is used by the cells to make proteins which contains green pigment in our eyes. So there are different pigmentation: blue, black, brown. Okay, so the genes for these proteins are present on the DNA. Okay, then why we need new cells? Why we need to study this chapter? So we need new cells for the growth. So why there is growth? Because the number of cells is increasing. And why the number of cells are increasing? Because the cells are dividing. Then for replacement, if you get any hurt or get a scratch on the skin, what happens? Does it remain for lifelong? No. The weird and tiered cells will be replaced, and their place will be taken up by the new cells. And from where these new cells are coming? Again, by the process of cell division. So the dead, weird and tiered cells are replaced by the new cells, because the cells are performing the process of cell division. In the same manner, for repair, if any cells gets tiered or not able to function properly, then in that case the cells will be replaced by the new cells. So there are two types of cells in our body: somatic cells and the germinal cells. The cells which helps in the growth, development and maintenance of our body parts is known as somatic cells. So the cells which will perform the process of growth, replacement, repair, maintenance, such cells will be the somatic cells. And the somatic cells will undergo a type of cell division known as mitosis. This type of cell division is known as mitosis. Whereas the cells which takes part in the process of reproduction is known as germinal cells, and the germinal cells will undergo the process of cell division, and that type of cell division is known as meiosis. Okay, so meiosis and mitosis. In the next class, we will be starting with the cell cycle, and we will see the two types of cell division in the next class. This is all for today. Thank you, everyone.